I'm Jericho Reid, and with me we have Jim Campbell. How are you, Jim?
I'm good, thank you.
So we're coming into the home stretch, the business end of the festival and other cliches. How has it been for you so far?
Yeah, it's been nice. It's been what I wanted it to be, basically. I'm enjoying the show. I've had a decent crowd. I've had some nice reviews. So yeah, it's been good. I mean, I basically, you know, it's my first show, so I've had my whole life to write it. So I had no excuse for it to not be ready getting up here. So weirdly, sort of the most relaxing part of the whole process of getting the show together has been the Fringe itself, because it's done. And it's, you know, I've made minor tweaks here and there, but it's, yeah, it's been enjoyable.
You say that you had your whole life to prepare for it. I really like the title of your show. Do you mind explaining the concept behind it?
Well, I turned 30 this year, and the way I see it is that you become a man at 21, so that means I am a 9-year-old man. And it's not, so it's not really about turning 30, that's a sort of point. Cliche thing that a lot of people do, but that is just part of it. It's a feature within it. It's about quite a lot of different things. I don't really want to give away too much. But that's it.
Okay, yeah. I also don't want to give away too much, but I don't want to come across all Daily Mail, but I'd say that your show is a brilliant insight into 21st century Britain. But rather than the paranoia and screaming scaremongering, your show is more positive and uplifting. Was that something you were convinced about at the beginning of your writing, or was it like a conclusion that you came to?
I think I'm quite a positive person generally. I do enjoy a good moan, and I do have a kind of cynicism to me, but generally I find myself being positive about things generally. I wanted the show to have something where you can sort of, the take home needs to be a positive thing,
yeah.
It needs to be a happy thing that people remember. And you know, when you say about how it's about 21st century life, it is kind of about the rest of the development, and my generation and your generation as well. It's sort of going through that. People stay young for longer now, if that makes sense. Sort of, adolescence seems to last a bit longer, and it seems to extend every generation. It's happening again. And so, I mean, there's positive things about that as well. You know, we're lucky to be able to sort of still, you know, be quite childish in a lot of ways as we get older. I think that's a great thing.
Okay, well, that's completely preempted the next question. So I will score that one off straight away and continue my Daily Mail audition by jingoistically branding you one of us. You have Scottish heritage, is that true?
I do have Scottish heritage, yeah. Like my family are from right here in Edinburgh. I'm part of the Cammy clan, so obviously we have we've done some things that I'm maybe not so proud of in the past, sort of a bit of murders, some treachery. In fact, I met Alistair Campbell once and he stole my pen. So we will even just, you know, screw each other over. It's just what we do.
Well, yes, after seeing your show, I'd say that your family castle has taken the number one spot on my list of castles.
Your list of
castles? Surpassed Edinburgh.
Yeah, if you don't know what the Campbell clan's castle is called, it's called Castle Gloom. So yeah, if anyone can top that, let me know. And don't pick Castle Grayskull, because that isn't real.
So this is your Fringe debut. You said you've had your whole life around the show. How's that experience been for you? And how do you imagine the next one's going to be? Are you going to need another lifetime?
It's my fourth Fringe. It's my first solo show, so I know what the Fringe is all about. You know, I've been up here before, but not doing a sort of full-length show. So the writing process of it was really enjoyable. It kind of morphed into being a theme show, into being a story show. I had something happen that actually fit the tone of the show, so it was worked out quite well in a strange way. I mean, you've seen the show, so you know why I say it's strange, and that worked out well. But so I think for the next one, it's difficult because you need to do a better show in a year.
Second album's
absolutely, but I mean, still, you have access to every funny thing that has ever happened to you. And sometimes you might be telling a story anecdotally and just completely forgotten about it. You've told a thousand times. You think, oh, I'm a stand-up since I've last told this story. Maybe I can just put it in. And sometimes it just works. So you know, it's just about it's working hard. You get out what you put in. So I'm really looking forward to next year because it's a blank slate. You know, I'm not thinking, right, I need this material in, I need that material. I decide what the show is now in a way that I've done kind of less so this year. So I'm really looking forward to it. Actually, it's a challenge, and you know, what is life without that?
And finally, in the off chance that Zooey Deschanel is a fan of Waffle TV, if you were to give yourself a moniker in the form of Manic Pixie Dream Girl, would that be Jim Selmer?
If I was sending myself to Zooey Deschanel?
Yeah, it's a hard task.
It is a hard task. I think I'd just drop to my knees and say, please!
That's
good. But I suppose I'm kind of a whimsical indie man, aren't I, really? That's whimsical indie men are the types that like the Manic Pixie Dream Girl, so
they go together.
Yeah.
Well, thank you for talking to us, and best of luck with the rest of your show.
Thank you very much.